Hey guys, Kay here from Kegland, and really excited. We have just had our first container of the VineCo Wine Kits, which have just arrived from Canada. These guys, we really wanted to partner with because they had such a wide range of wine kits available of all different types and all different varieties from different countries. So literally got wine kits from made from grapes from, you know, Italy, from Spain, from America, even from Australia and New Zealand. And they've also got these kits with everything included. So some of the kits, like the reds in particular, for instance, will have like oak chips and fining agents and yeast already included. And other ones like this will just have yeast included, for instance, if that's all they need. But because they're a fully inclusive package, basically all you need to do is buy the kit, add a little bit of water to top it up, and of course put it into your type of fermenter. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna ferment a couple of these out. We've got the range here starting from the Signature Series, so I'm gonna do this red wine here. We've got a Merlot, which I'm gonna drop down. Also, you've got the Estate Series, Original Series, Après, and also the Niagara Mist as well. So they're basically going from the premium ones. As you can see, the premium ones are a bigger box, because basically there's less evaporative process to, you know, concentrate the grapes. So because they haven't gone through that sort of as much of an evaporative process, it's really a premium product. But yeah, some of the ones as they go down in price range might have a little bit more of the evaporated product, so you have to add a little bit more water to them. But yeah, what I'm gonna do in this instance, yeah, we're gonna get the Niagara Mist. Now, typically, if you follow the exact recipe that comes with the kit, it actually says the Niagara Mist is a still product, so I'm not gonna have it carbonated. However, look, I'm gonna try this Niagara Mist peach flavor unit here we got. I'm gonna drop it into the Firmzilla All-Rounder and carbonate it in here and then put it through my keg system. So I'm gonna see what that's like carbonated. Now, of course, you can do exactly the same thing with the white wines as well. Like these white wines that we sell, yeah, they're generally, if you follow the recipe exactly, it says, you know, brew it as a still wine. However, if you did want to carbonate it, it's just like carbonating beer. So if you're already one of our customers making beer from time to time, you'll find that really straightforward. With the red wine here, I'm going to put this into a Firmzilla flat bottom that we got here. Look, a lot of winemakers who aren't using pressure or carbonate or anything like that, this is probably one of the easiest fermenters to use. And it's also important to remember that it's a couple step process. So you might want to buy two fermenters in particular, so you can rack it off from one fermenter to the next. That's generally what's done in the wine process, sometimes two times or even maybe three times if you want to get a really, really clear product at the end. Anyway, let's get into it and get some wine underway. Okay, so we're gonna go with the Niagara Mist first. I've already got some sanitizer in here and given it a good shake. I've also dispensed some through the liquid dip tube here. So I'm gonna take this lid off and take this guy out of here. And I'm gonna pour out the sanitizer. Alrighty, so inside this box, what I've got is some preservatives. So I've got some sulfides. Now, if you guys are sensitive to sulfides, this is one of the reasons you might want to get into making wine yourself. Now, in this particular instance, I'm not going to add the sulfides, but with this particular kit, it's important to remember I've got the juice bags. This is going to be fully fermented out. But then I've also got the flavor bags. This has got, in this particular instance, some of the peach flavors and peach juice in here. And if I don't add the preservative, once I've added this at the end of the process, I don't want these final flavors to ferment out. So what I'm gonna do is leave the sulfides out of there. Then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna chill this particular fermenter and then chill it when it's in the fridge. So because I'm always gonna keep this product cold, it's not gonna start re-fermenting. So I'm gonna combat that particular situation that way. So I've got that in there. I've also got some bentonite. So the bentonite I'm gonna dissolve in this hot water, which I've got in this jug here. I'm gonna pour that in there now. And with my sanitized spoon as well, I'm just gonna give that a bit of a stir. Now, it's quite normal for the bentonite not to 100% dissolve just in the water like this, so don't be concerned, but if you do use hot water to try and speed up the dissolving process of the bentonite, just remember to cool that water down to about 35 degrees or lower before you drop it into a PET fermenter. So all of the Firmzillas are made out of PET and they don't really like boiling hot water. So just be wary of that one. Then I'm gonna keep these other sachets, which basically are some fining agents. I'm gonna add them later on. So in goes this one. As you've seen in other videos, I just find it easier to chop the bag open. So I'm gonna just chop the corner open like this. And just give it a little sanitize there. Now I'm gonna top it up with a little bit of tap water. And then what I'm going to do is chuck on the EC118, which comes with this particular kit, and sprinkle that one on top. Now it looks like I'm slightly below 23 litres, so I'm just going to go to the kitchen, get a little bit more tap water, and top it up to the 23 litre mark. All right, now the bentonite that I had with hot water here has cooled down a bit, so I'm going to drop that in the fermenter. Now lastly, before I leave this to ferment out, the other thing I want to make sure I do is get an initial gravity reading. So if you've got a hydrometer, this is where you'd want to get a sample and do that. But in this particular instance, I'm just using one of these wrapped pills. So this is one of our digital hydrometers, which is going to do the job for us. So I'm going to get this guy and just drop it in there. That one was just pre-calibrated a few moments ago. So that's all ready to go. The other thing I'm going to do is just on the top here, basically clip on a disconnect and just add an airlock. So I'm going to do that later. All right, so I'm going to do this Cab Sav red wine kit. This is one of the signature series, so it's the top of the line of products. Now inside the bag, what I've got is I've got the grape skins here. Obviously that's to give it some tannin and color. I've got the juice bag here. I've also got some oak chips. Bentonite as well, so I've got the bentonite. I'm just going to start dissolving that straight away into some hot water once again. So same as before, so just chucking that in there and giving a bit of a stir. Now while that one's dissolving, we're also going to get our grape skins sorted out. Let me just grab that teaspoon and spray my hand with a bit of ethanol sanitizer and grab that teaspoon back out of there. Whoops. and we are going to get our musts ready. So for the grape skins, I'm going to use this muslin bag here. And basically, I've got one end which should be open and one end which is sewn together like so. I'm going to dip this in sanitizer. Jug previously had sanitizer in it already, so I should be okay there. Line the bag like that. Oops. So my grape skins are going to go in here. Squeeze these out into the mesh bag here. Now I'm going to add the oak chips. I've got a few bags in this particular kit. So once you've got all the ingredients in, just make sure you've fully topped up all the way to the 23 litre mark. All right, now I've finished pouring all the water in up to 23 litre mark. Last step is to add the yeast on top like that. So this one also includes the EC118. And if I had a long sanitized spoon handy, I'd probably give it a really vigorous stir to just stir everything up. But I'm a little bit lazy, so I'm just gonna give this guy a good old shake like that. And shaking's not such a bad thing to do because it really helps some of that oxygen which is in the headspace dissolve into solution. And at this early stage of the fermentation process, oxygenation is obviously a really good thing because it helps the yeast really get cracking and starts to multiply. All right, that's it. And this is going into the fermentation chamber. So now that this is 14 days in, it's already finished fermenting, and luckily, the particular fermentation that I've had here, it's ended up with quite a clear result. So inside the kit, I've got clarifying agents and sulfides and the chitosand mix, but in this particular instance, I've been lucky enough that it's clear enough for what I'm doing, so I'm just actually going to pour this into the keg, carbonate it up in here, and I'm going to basically serve this as a carbonated beverage. If you look at the instructions that come with a kit like this, it actually, the instructions tell you to basically turn this into a still wine, but, you know, I'm sort of moving away from the norm here, so if you want to go down this path, you know, yeah you can if you want to. But, yeah, what I'm doing in here is also going to emit the sulfides. As I was saying before, I'm going to have an attempt at making a sulfide-free wine, so no preservatives. But if you're going to do that, you have to be very careful not to get oxygen in there, because that's one of the major reasons why I'm adding the sulfides. They basically absorb oxygen and prevent the wine from oxidizing and essentially going off and tasting bad. So with kegging, that's a lot easier to do than bottling, I should also say. This is a pressurizable fermenter, so I can use a CO2 gas and basically push the gas into the top of the fermenter, and that's going to push that into the keg. So that process means I don't have to undo the lid and use a gravity transfer and stuff like that. And because I'm not taking the lid off, it means I'm also reducing the oxygen getting into the fermenter, meaning that, you know, I've got the best chance of this succeeding. So, I've got my little sampling tap here as well. It's always good to have a sample of a product as well before you go into the final packaging, so you can really taste what it's like. I already know the gravity, as mentioned before, but I also want to have a bit of a taste to just be 100% sure no other additions or changes are required before I go to the final step. I've got a duotight ball lock disconnect with a 1/4 inch, and I'm just using a Bronco tap. So I'm push these two guys together like that. And I'm just going to go onto the outpost here. So that's obviously the one with the dip tube connected. Click that guy on. I've got a tiny bit of pressure in here. So it'll just be enough to get a little sample. So as you can see, that's a really, really quite a clear result. And what I'm going to do is have a taste. That is really, really quite dry. I can see why they've got this juice kit, because that has fermented right out. The EC1118 yeast that you're putting in here, it's an aggressive yeast. It flocculates out really well, but it also, it really dries a lot of those juices right out, which is why it's often used in like champagnes and ciders and stuff like that. So, it's good. Look, I can't smell any defects. It smells pretty good, tastes pretty good, so I'm going to go to the final step. Alrighty, so I've got the keg here. This one's already sanitized and cleaned out, and I'm going to pour the juice kit in here. Going to take the lid. There's a little bit of pressure in here because actually we already purged this keg out with CO2 as well. I'm going to put that on the bench. And I've got this juice kit here. There we go. And in she goes. Okay, so I'm connecting the gas, as I mentioned a second ago, onto this post here. I've got the regulator set at about 20 psi or so. So that's all done. So that's sort of going into that bit there. Then I'm going to get this transfer tube. So the transfer tube, I'm actually using a larger gauge hose than I normally use. I'm using the 3/8 or the 6mm ID by 9.5mm OD. So the larger gauge means it's going to, you know, push the liquid through a little bit quicker. The other thing I've got on here is the duo tight Borlock disconnects with the 3/8 push in as well, so they're a little bit larger gauge. So it's a good idea to also sanitize this guy. Got a bit of ethanol spray here. Gonna get it on those as well. And push that on there. And push the other side just onto the outpost on that side like that. And that's transferring straight away. You can hear that's transferring fairly rapidly there. The other thing I'm going to do is you could sit here and every now and then pull the pressure release valve like that, because obviously you need to let the pressure out of here so this liquid can displace that gas. But you know, it's just a little bit easier if I've got a blow tie unit here, so I'm just going to drop this on the gas post, and that way there's going to be a controlled amount of residual head pressure on the output side. So I'm not just opening it completely to atmosphere and potentially letting oxygen go in that way. Probably not much you'd get in anyway because I'm pushing the gas out, but you know, that's pretty much it. Okay, so we're towards the end of this process. It's been filling for about, probably about 60 seconds or something like that. So yeah, we're getting close to the end. So I'm gonna loosen these straps up on the side and I'm gonna tilt the fermenter a little bit towards where the dip tube and the filter is. Got to be really gentle, guys. This bit, I really don't want to get that sediment in there, but quite a lot of sediment because I haven't actually racked this off at all. I'm just going straight from the primary into the final keg. And to be honest with you, because I haven't done any racking or anything like that, I've probably also done a good job at limiting my chance of getting oxygen exposure. But I really don't want to suck in all that yeast at the end. So I'm probably going to cut this about, look, I'm going to probably call it there. Look, there's not that much to get, but the rest of it there is, to be honest with you, I've got a little bit of liquid, a little bit of yeast. I've probably sacrificed, I don't know, maybe 400 mils at most. But anyway, so I've got a full keg here. Disconnect that bad boy. Disconnect this bad boy here. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to chill this in my keg. Now, you will definitely have small amounts of yeast in here, and because we've added this sugary liquid in here and we're not using these the sulfides and the sorbate mix, this potentially could ferment again. So if you are using this method, not using any preservatives or any sorbate like that, anything like that, you will have to keep this refrigerated, otherwise it will continue to ferment and the sugars that I've added here will ferment right out. It'll get really overcarbonated, and the recipe will be will be higher in alcohol than what it's intended to be, and a lot drier than it's meant to be as well. So yeah, I'm gonna whack this in the kegerator and it'll be done and carbonated in a couple of days from now. Alrighty, so we are now at day 14. I've already checked the gravity yesterday, but I'm gonna check again today to just make sure it's the same. Obviously, if the gravity's still moving, I wanna make sure I let it ferment for a little bit longer. But the gravity yesterday was already about 996, or 0.0996, I should say. So I'll just check it again now. And it is pretty much exactly the same. Yeah, look, it hasn't moved at all. So yeah, that means that I've got to about 13% alcohol, which means I'm pretty much all done. And now it's time to get the must out of here. So I've got that mesh bag of must. I'm going to pull that out. So what I'm going to do for that is I'm going to get these gloves here. And I've got this sanitized spoon here as well, which I might find handy. Now, this is going to be slightly messy, I'll say. So I've got a bin just behind me here, and I've also got a little rag ready to go just in case I spill anything. Got that all done. Sanitize my hands with a bit of ethanol spray, what I'm using today. Now what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to get this bag out, but ideally I don't want to disturb everything that's settled out at the bottom. So I'm going to do this fairly carefully. I'm going to just squeeze this out. Now there's still going to be a little bit of clarifying to come as well. So if it's not perfectly clear at this stage, it's okay. But you know, before I do rack it off into another fermenter, you're always trying to, at each stage, keep it as clear as possible to leave that sediment behind. So I'm going to squeeze this out. Now, depending on how much you squeeze it, you can be as thrifty as you want and squeeze it all out. But look, it is quite a bit of red wine anyway. So if there's, you know, a small amount of losses, it's not the end of the world, really. I should say, though, yeah, by squeezing this out, you're really going to extract that beautiful oaky goodness and that and those tannins that you probably want in a good red wine. Okay, that's pretty good. I've got most of it out there. Now I'm just going to gently put this back on top to stop, you know, any stuff in the air falling in or flies falling in. Now we're going to transfer what's in here into here. Now some of you guys might use a racking cane depending on the type of fermenter you've got. This particular flat bottom has a tap on it, making it pretty easy. I've got the lid just ajar like that so it doesn't suck the sanitizer I've got in the airlock back into the wine. And I've got this lid just sort of gently sitting on top just to stop stuff, you know, falling into this fermenter, which is also sanitized here as well. So I'm going to turn the tap on now, get that guy flowing. Alrighty, so that's going in there nicely. The other thing I've got to do in this one is add the sulfide. So this one, I'm going to put some basically preservative in there. Some of you guys might be sensitive to preservative. You might want to not do this, but I'm going to chuck this one in. And I'm just going to sprinkle this in. Now, you could wait for the whole thing to finish filling up, but look, I'm just going to chuck this. There's enough wine in there now. I can chuck it in there now, and it'll start dissolving into solution there. Now, if you're not using any of the sulfides, it's really important to be really careful not to keep, not to get oxygen in there. So I wouldn't be doing this style of transfer if I wasn't using sulfides. I'd probably be using an all-rounder fermenter and doing some type of pressure transfer or something like that, which is a lot more stuffing around, I guess. Alrighty, so I've got to the end of this process now. It's just starting to suck a tiny bit of air, but I'm going to squeeze a little bit more wine out of this fermenter here, just by giving it a small tilt. Now, you do have to be a bit careful here when you start tilting, because I don't really want to get all that yeast and sediment. I'm trying to leave that behind, so, you know, it's up to you how thrifty you want to be here. But I'm basically getting pretty close to the end now. Look, there's probably only a few hundred mils left in there, I'd say, worth collecting. But look, just to be safe, I think I'm gonna cut it there. Yeah, that's pretty good. Look, I've got all the good stuff, really, when you think about it. So I'm gonna lift this out and put this on the ground. So I'll lift this guy out of the way. Now, some of you guys might want to wash this other fermenter out because some of the wine kits actually, you may want to even rack off a third time. Now, I hope this is not going to be necessary, but look, it's hard to know how clarified the wine's going to be until you've actually just finished the process. But yeah, if that is the case, obviously I'd clean that one out, then go from this one into another fermenter. I'm just going to lift this up onto the bench here as well, so you guys can see a little bit better. Okay. All right, and now it's time to basically degas what I've got in here. So the fermentation process creates a lot of CO2. And some of that CO2 is still going to be in solution. So a lot of you guys at home have got one of these brewing spoons. So what you can do is just for 10 minutes, just give it a vigorous stir like that and then reverse the direction and stir it like that and do that for 10 minutes. However, you know, I've got this, you know, mash paddle here, which I use for brewing. Fits on the end of a drill pretty well. I've just chopped the little tip, which has the hole through the end. So this fits on the end of the drill. I've already given this a good sanitize with the ethanol spray. So I'm going to use the drill to do this because I'm kind of lazy. Now I'm reversing the direction every now and then, like that. And then going forward again. Now I'm trying not to scratch the insides of the fermenter.
Ideally, I don't want to be whacking up against the walls if I can avoid it, because you know, it's kind of nice if you can reduce the number of potential infection points on the inside of your fermenters and keep them really smooth. All right, so that's about 4 minutes. So I've done with that process. And the last thing before I put the lid back on is I'm just gonna chuck in this Kiasol. Now, if you've got two sachets of Kiasol in your kit, this is where you wanna add one of them and leave the other one for a little bit later. So I'm gonna chop that open and then just drop the contents of that in there. And then close this guy up and leave it for one more day for the next step. So we're at day 15, and I've had a little bit of a check with the torch, I must say, and just had a look at the wine, and it's still got a little bit of cloudiness there, so we need to clarify it a little bit more. The kit obviously includes the clarification agent. We've got the chitter sand here, so I'm gonna basically add that now. Let's give that a little ethanol spray down here and the knife, which I'm gonna cut the bag open with. And then I'm gonna open this one up like that. Now, if you have oak cubes, this is when you'd also be adding the oak cubes to get that oaky flavor. Now, this particular recipe had oak chips rather than cubes, so we've already added them earlier on, as you'd remember. But just so you're aware, there's a difference between the directions for cubes and chips. Thought I'd just mention that one. Okay, so I'm gonna cut this one open. I'm just going to give it a tiny little stir like this. I don't want to move it around too much because obviously I've already got a lot of that sediment which is settled to the bottom. So I don't want to shake it up and vigorously sort of stir everything up. I just want to make sure that that chitter sand is fully incorporated. All right, and I'll come back in 1 hour to add the final Kiasol sachet. Now, just like before, I'm gonna add the Kiasol, so I'm gonna sanitize this down and sanitize my knife to cut the bag open. I've got this one already undone like so. Now, ideally, I wanna get the lid straight back on so we're not getting too much oxygen into the opening. I mean, because we have added sulfides to this wine, that will absorb some of the oxygen. But yeah, just tightly do that up. Make sure your airlock's full, and then just give it a little swirl like that. You don't want to jiggle it around too much. We're just trying to incorporate the ingredients, that's it. So I'm gonna let this sit now for up to 8 weeks to settle. You'll have to look at your particular recipe, and also just check it, keep an eye on it. Put it in a cool, dark place, and then have a look every now and then, and see if all that sediment has settled out, because once it's all settled out and cleared up, it's ready for bottling. Okay, now we're at day 26. We've kind of sped up the clarification process because we had the fermenter sitting in one of our wrap fermentation chambers and we then chilled it to -4 degrees, so things clarified pretty quickly. So that's kind of really sped it up for us. Some of you guys might have to wait a little bit longer to clarify if you're just in open air. The other thing I've got is basically a bottling tree. I've got this sanitizing squirty thingy. So that basically sits on top of the bottling tree like so. And then I've sanitized already all of these bottles like that. And I've given them a few minutes to just drain out on the bottling tree. So that's all done. I've also got my corks in here. Now we of course sell all the bottles separately. They're basically sold as a box of 12. With the bottles, when you buy those boxes of 12, they include the corks, also include the shrink wrap, which goes over the top of the wine bottles as well. So it's kind of handy that, you know, the bottles all come inclusive as a kit. This sanitizer and the bottle tree are also sold separately. So let's get stuck into it. I've got this sanitized bottle. I just push it up onto this pressure activated tip here and the bottle should start filling. The ferment is kind of precariously balanced on the top of a couple of cardboard boxes here, so I've got to sort of move a bit carefully here. But hopefully at home you rig up something a little bit more stable than this. You don't want heaps of splashing, which is why we use a pressure activated tip. You could just go open the tap and splash into the bottle, but honestly, the oxidation will really affect the shelf life of the wine. So really it's better to use a bottle filling tip like this. Whoop, and there we go, fill that up. That's done. And then I get one of my sanitized corks, drop it in the corking machine.
and then put this onto the top of the bottle. Now you want to make sure you've got a bit of elbow room and you're on a nice firm bench, because you have to use a bit of pressure to get this in, like so.
Now with the labels, if you buy the bottles from us, we generally will include some labels like this. So they're our handcrafted labels. You can buy more labels separately if you want to. VineCo kits also include these labels as well. So you can either stick one of these on, but I'm gonna go with my own, because I've already labeled this one Chateau Kegland. So that is ready to go here. Next, I need to put the shrink wrap on top of the bottle and then just get the heat gun onto this bad boy. And she is all done. So that is a professionally labeled bottle, all heat shrinked, ready to go. All right, now the moment of truth. We've got the Nigra Mist here. Now this one I actually just poured straight off the kegerator. It's beautifully clear because it's been sitting in the keg for a little bit longer. It's clarified really well. Looks kind of like champagne, I guess you might say. And really fruity. To be honest with you, it's a little on the sweet side. Look, had I made this kit again, I'd probably add probably half of that juice pack at the end, because that juice pack has brought in a lot of sugars. I probably would say add the juice pack a little bit, or maybe a third, taste it, then add another third, taste it, and then add the whole lot if you really think it's not sweet enough. But the guys in the office have tasted this as well, and they love it. Definitely, so a lot of the guys in the office love it, but for me, that's probably a little bit on the sweet side, but easy to solve. One thing I will say is it doesn't have any signs of oxidation at all. So even though we didn't use any preservative in that one, the fact that we put it in a keg, put CO2 pressure into it and carbonated it, it's kept all the oxygen off. So, I think that's a really good job in that respect. With the red, this Cab Sav, I've been wanting to try for a while. It's still a little bit cool because literally we crash chilled all the wine and we just literally filled all these bottles up then, but that is a cracker. Now, I'm deadly serious. That is a real cracker. Look, I've drunk a lot of wine and yeah, that does the job. And honestly, it's like quite a good value proposition. I think the kit, I've made like 24 odd bottles or so. And they're amazing. Yeah, I definitely would drink this. Anyway, if you guys want to hear about any of the other cool stuff that's coming up, definitely bottom right hand corner, subscribe now and join our Facebook homebrew community group. We've got lots of other guys sharing tips and tricks on how to get the most out of the gear. But guys, get into the wines. They're awesome. Something different. Give it a go. All right, see ya.